From New York, this is Democracy Now!
I stand here today knowing that my Howard University education prepared me to play Jackie Robinson, James Brown, Thurgood Marshall, and T'Challa.
The beloved actor Chadwick Boseman has died at the age of 43 after a secret four-year battle with colon cancer. Boseman's best known for his iconic role as King T'Challa in the groundbreaking Black Panther superhero film. His first leading role was playing Jackie Robinson in the film 42.
Give me a uniform. Give me a number on my back. I'll give you the guts.
Chadwick Boseman died on Friday. We'll speak with cancer survivor, author, and professor Ibram X. Kendi. Friday marked 2 years since he underwent surgery to remove tumors. It's a day he calls his second birthday. We'll talk about Chadwick Boseman, his fight against cancer, racial disparities in healthcare, Trump, white supremacy, and how to be an anti-racist.
I think we can't just talk about racism as an original sin. We have to talk about racism as the original cancer, as this original disease that has been killing America. It almost prevented Americans from coming together and forming a union in at its founding.
All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman. Protests are continuing in Kenosha, Wisconsin, 1 week after the police shooting of Jacob Blake and days after a white 17-year-old militia member killed two Black Lives Matter protesters. At least 1,000 National Guard troops were on the ground in Kenosha during weekend rallies. Reports have emerged of what are believed to be unidentified federal agents abducting protesters before detaining them without charges. When asked by a reporter in New Hampshire, President Trump addressed the shooting of Jacob Blake Friday, defending the police officer who shot him. Trump said, "People can make a mistake. That doesn't make them bad. They choked." Trump is set to visit Kenosha Tuesday, even after Wisconsin Governor Tony Evers pleaded with him Sunday to reconsider. Evers wrote in a letter, quote, "I am concerned your presence will only hinder our healing. I am concerned your presence will only delay our work to overcome division," the governor said. In Portland, Oregon, one person was shot dead Saturday at a pro-Trump caravan rally. The man who was killed was wearing a hat with the insignia of far-right group Patriot Prayer. The identity of the shooter is still unknown. Before the fatal shooting, the pro-Trump caravan of hundreds clashed with anti-racist protesters who've been taking to the streets for 3 straight months following the police killing of George Floyd. In the span of several hours early Sunday, President Trump unleashed a tweet storm in which he, among other things, retweeted conspiracy theories about the protests being a coup to remove him from office. He also attacked Portland Mayor Ted Wheeler. This is Mayor Wheeler responding to Trump Sunday.
"It's you who have created the hate and the division. It's you who have not found a way to say the names of Black people killed by police officers, even as people in law enforcement have. And it's you who claimed that white supremacists are good people. Your campaign of fear is as anti-democratic as anything you've done to create hate and vitriol in our beautiful country."
In related news, an appeals court last week halted an order protecting journalists and legal observers in Portland from being removed by federal agents. The number of confirmed COVID-19 cases in the United States has topped 6 million, with a death toll over 183,000. More than 1 million people tested positive over the past 3 weeks in the U.S. A number of states are now reporting record number of cases, including Iowa, North and South Dakota. Over 4,000 Americans died of COVID-19 during last week's Republican National Convention. That's more than the total number number of people killed in the 9/11 attacks. But President Trump is attempting to downplay the death toll. On Sunday, he retweeted a message from a far-right website falsely claiming just 9,000 people have died from COVID-19. Twitter deleted the original tweet, saying it violates its rules. In education news, more than 1,200 students at the University of Alabama have tested positive since classes resumed in August. CNN is reporting 8,700 total cases have already been reported on college campuses nationwide. In medical news, the Food and Drug Administration's approved the use of remdesivir for all patients hospitalized with COVID-19, despite the lack of published scientific support. Meanwhile, the FDA has ousted its top spokeswoman and a PR consultant just days after FDA Commissioner Stephen Hahn apologized for overstating the positive results of using blood plasma as a treatment for COVID-19. Under enormous pressure from President Trump, who, with others in the administration, called the FDA part of the deep state, the FDA recently gave emergency use authorization for the plasma treatment. The FDA chief is now admitting the agency may also consider emergency use approval for a COVID-19 vaccine before phase 3 trials are complete. The number of reported COVID-19 cases across the globe has surpassed 25 million. More than 840,000 people have died. On Sunday, India reported nearly 79,000 new cases, the highest single-day tally for any country in the world. Authorities in Gaza have extended a lockdown amidst fears of a broader COVID-19 outbreak in the occupied territory. In news from Latin America, Peru now has the highest number of deaths from COVID-19 per capita in the world. Nearly 29,000 people have died in Peru from the virus. Meanwhile, in Germany, more than 300 people, including many far-right activists, have been arrested following a large demonstration in Berlin protesting against public health measures taken to combat the pandemic. Some protesters attempted to storm the Reichstag building, Germany's parliament. Tributes continue to pour in for the beloved actor Chadwick Boseman after he died Friday at the age of 43 after a four-year secret battle with colon cancer. Boseman is best known for his iconic role as King T'Challa in the groundbreaking Black Panther, the first mainstream Black superhero movie. He was also widely acclaimed for his portrayal of major historical figures like Thurgood Marshall, James Brown, and Jackie Robinson. This is Boseman speaking alongside the Black Panther cast as they accepted the top award at the 2019 Screen Actors Guild Awards.
We all know what it's like to be told that there is not a place for you to be featured, yet you are young, gifted, and Black. We know what it's like to be told to say there's not a screen for you to be featured on, a stage for you to be featured on. We know what it's like to be the tail and not the head. We know what it's like to be beneath and not above. And that is what we went to work with every day, because we knew not that we would be around during award season or that it would make $1 billion, but we knew that we had something special that we wanted to give the world, that we could be full human beings in the roles that we were playing. That we could create a world that exemplified a world that we wanted to see.
That was Chadwick Boseman. After headlines, we'll spend the hour talking about Boseman, Black Panther, President Trump, white supremacy, with another cancer survivor. We'll speak with Professor Kendi. Tens of thousands gathered in Washington, D.C. Friday on the 57th anniversary of the March on Washington. The Get Your Knee Off Our Necks rally was organized to protest systemic racism and police brutality. Speakers included Jacob Blake Sr., whose son was shot 7 times at point-blank range in the back last week by a police officer in Kenosha, Wisconsin.
We're going to hold court today. We're going to hold court on systematic racism. We're going to have court right now. Guilty. Yeah. Guilty. 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 Racism against all of us. Guilty!
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 Racism against Trayvon Martin. We find them guilty!
Guilty!
Racism against George Floyd. We find them guilty!
Martin Luther King Jr.'s 12-year-old granddaughter, Yolanda Renee King, also spoke.
Less than a year before he was assassinated, my grandfather predicted this very moment. He said that we were moving into a new phase of the struggle. The first phase was the civil rights, and the new phase is genuine equality.
Lebanon's ambassador to Germany, Mustafa Adib, has been tasked with forming a new government following the resignation earlier this month of Prime Minister Hassan Diab amidst mounting public rage over the devastating explosion at the port of Beirut that killed 200 people and injured thousands. Adib has served as Lebanon's ambassador to Germany since 2013 and has received the backing from the country's Sunni Muslim political leaders. In Belarus, mass protests demanding the resignation of President Alexander Lukashenko continued this weekend, 3 weeks after what many have called a rigged election, amidst a brutal government crackdown. Military tanks could be seen positioned in the capital, Minsk. At least 19 journalists who work for foreign media outlets have had their accreditation revoked, and two Associated Press reporters were deported. At least 400 refugees are stranded in the Mediterranean Sea as European officials are denying rescue ships permission to come ashore. Many of those stranded migrants have been traveling on a ship funded by British street artist Banksy, who's accusing officials of ignoring distress calls from rescue vessels. In related news, at least three refugees died this weekend when a boat carrying around 20 people caught on fire on the southern coast of Italy. In Mauritius, tens of thousands protested Saturday over the government's response to a catastrophic oil spill last month. The discovery of dozens of dead dolphins and melon-headed whales has compounded public anger and demands for an impartial investigation. Conservationists have warned the spill from the Japanese fuel tanker MV Wakashio threatens protected coral reefs and a number of endangered species. In Sudan, the government and an alliance of rebel groups in Darfur have signed a peace deal in the hopes of putting an end to 17 years of conflict. The deal covers key issues around land ownership, transitional justice, power sharing, and the return of people who fled because of war. It also paves the way for the dismantling of rebel forces and for members to be integrated into the national army. The United Nations is warning the life of Congolese doctor, Nobel Peace Prize laureate Dr. Denis Mukwege, is in danger after he received a series of death threats. Dr. Mukwege founded the Panzi Hospital in the Democratic Republic of Congo, which treats women requiring surgery as a result of sexual violence. He's been targeted for his work before and survived an assassination attempt in 2012. In Pakistan, torrential rains have killed at least 13 people and submerged large swaths of Karachi, Pakistan's largest city. The record-breaking rains this month are 10 times the monthly average and the worst since record-keeping began some 90 years ago. Last week, over 8 inches of rain fell in a period of just 12 hours, all this in the midst of the coronavirus pandemic. Back in the United States in Louisiana, immigrants detained at the LaSalle and Jackson Parish Correctional Centers are denouncing unlivable conditions inside the Immigration and Customs Enforcement prisons after Hurricane Laura battered the state. According to prisoners, the two jails have flooded with urine and feces, don't have electricity, clean food or water, and don't have air circulation, forcing prisoners to sleep outside, many in their underwear. As Louisiana residents now face the long road to recovery from Hurricane Laura, many also marked this weekend 15 years since Hurricane Katrina struck the Gulf Coast, killing over 1,800 people and devastating the city of New Orleans. On Friday, Black organizers and leaders from around the country held a virtual Black National Convention. The event, organized by the Movement for Black Lives, featured conversations on issues including electoral justice, the criminal justice system, labor, the climate crisis, disability justice, trans rights, feminism, and immigration. This is North Carolina activist Bree Newsom Bass, who was arrested 5 years ago for scaling a 30-foot flagpole at the South Carolina Capitol to remove the Confederate flag.
We're trying to transform a system that was, and a government that was fundamentally organized around our enslavement, right? So we're already alienated in many ways from that. But even beyond that, even when we, you know, elect someone who we can't consider a comrade or someone who, you know, has gone into the office promising to, you know, put forward our agenda, again, the reality is that the system that they come up against is so highly organized that if we are not organized on our end to both support them and to continue pushing, it will be very difficult for that person to do anything.
Democrats have slammed the announcement by the Director of National Intelligence, John Ratcliffe, Friday, that he's canceling in-person congressional election security briefings just over 2 months ahead of Election Day. The Trump administration said the cancellation was in order to prevent leaks and that written reports would be issued instead. In a joint statement, House Speaker Nancy Pelosi and Intelligence Committee Chair Adam Schiff called the change a shocking abdication of responsibilities of the DNI. And in New York, the family of Lalene Polanco, the 27-year-old transgender Afro-Latinx woman who was found dead in a jail cell at Rikers Island last year, has been awarded $5.9 million to settle a lawsuit against New York City. Polanco died from an epileptic seizure in June 2019 after she was left in solitary confinement for 9 days. Lalene Polanco was held at Rikers on $500 bail. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman. When we come back, we spend the hour with Dr. Ibram X. Kendi. Stay with us.
King of my city, king of my country, king of my homeland, king of the filthy, king of the fallen, we living again. King of the shooters, looters, boosters, and ghettos popping. King of the past, present, future, my ancestors watching. King of the culture, king of the soldiers, king of the bloodshed, king of the wisdom, king of the ocean, king of the respect, king of the optimistic and dreamers that go and get it. King of the winners, district and geniuses with conviction. King of the fighters, king of the fathers, king of the belated, king of the answer, king of the problem, king of the forsaken, king of the empathy and resentment, king of remorse, king of my enemies, may they fall defeat, I rejoice. King of the skyscrapers, dodging haters, pro religion. Now faces go against the mind, race them with precision. I embrace a wicked collision. Kings did it, king's vision. Black Panther, King Kendrick, all hail the king.
I dropped a million tears. I know several responsibilities put me here. I don't pedal backwards, but I live old-fashioned. The lens that I'm looking through won't prescribe you the right glasses. Masses are now free. Ashes I'm dumping out, about to spread all across seas. Sisters and brothers in
Black unison. Black Panther by Kendrick Lamar from the soundtrack to the superhero movie Black Panther. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman. Chadwick Boseman, the world-renowned actor, known best for his groundbreaking role in the 2018 blockbuster hit Black Panther, died on Friday at the age of 43 after a private four-year battle with colon cancer. News of his passing shocked the public and sparked a wave of tributes to the man who played Jackie Robinson, the first Black athlete to play Major League Baseball, Thurgood Marshall, the first Black justice on the U.S. Supreme Court, and, of course, superhero King T'Challa, all while being treated for cancer. A statement shared on Chadwick Boseman's Twitter said, quote, "A true fighter, Chadwick persevered through it all and brought you many of the films you've come to love so much, from Marshall to The Five Bloods, August Wilson's Ma Rainey's Black Bottom, and several more. All were filmed during and between countless surgeries and chemotherapy. It was the honor of his career to bring King T'Challa to life in Black Panther." Twitter announced the post was the, quote, "most liked tweet ever. A tribute fit for a king. Hashtag Wakanda forever." Black Panther is one of the highest grossing movies of all time, earning more than $1.3 billion around the world. It's been called a defining moment for Black America as the first superhero movie with a majority Black cast and an African lead character. This is a clip from the trailer of Black Panther.
Tell me something. What do you know about Wakanda?
It's a third world country.
Textiles, shepherds, cool outfits.
All the front. Explorers have searched for it. Called it El Dorado. They looked for it in South America. But was in Africa the whole time. I'm the only one who's seen it and made it out alive. Soon, there will only be the conquered and the conquerors.
Step into the spotlight.
You are a good man.
Step into the spotlight.
With a good heart. And it's hard for a good man to be a king.
Part of the trailer for Black Panther starring Chadwick Boseman. In 2018, Boseman returned to his alma mater, the historically black college, Howard University, to give the 2018 commencement address.
I stand here today knowing that my Howard University education prepared me to play Jackie Robinson, James Brown, Thurgood Marshall, and T'Challa. But what do you do when the principles and standards that were instilled in you here at Howard close the doors in front of you? Sometimes you need to get knocked down before you can really figure out what your fight is and how you need to fight it.
Boseman spoke as he was fighting for his life. Very few people knew this at the time. According to the American Cancer Society, rates of colon cancer are higher among black people, who are 40% more likely to die from the disease due to later diagnosis and systemic racism. For more, we go to Boston, Massachusetts, where we're joined by the anti-racist scholar Dr. Ibram X. Kendi, who himself has battled colon cancer and on Friday celebrated 2 years of being cancer-free. He tweeted Friday, the anniversary of his operation for cancer, quote, "I see August 28th as my second birthday." Ibram X. Kendi is founding director of the BU Center for Anti-Racist Research, contributing writer at The Atlantic, and the author of many books, including Stamped from the Beginning, The Definitive History of Racist Ideas in America, How to Be an Anti-Racist, and most recently, the children's book, Anti-Racist Baby. Dr. Kendi, welcome back to Democracy Now! On Friday, I was so thrilled to see your tweet. I mean, this was the 57th anniversary of the March on Washington, which, by the way, that date was chosen because back in 1955, it was the day Emmett Till was killed. But I was so thrilled to see you talking about this amazing moment for yourself 2 years ago. Talk about what happened. And then the end of that night, learning the news about Chadwick Boseman.
Yeah, I mean, August 28th is always going to be a second birthday for me. 2 years ago, I, you know, went under the knife literally all day long, not knowing, like many people who have stage four colon cancer or other forms of cancer, whether that surgery would begin the beginning of my survival or whether they would find something that they didn't expect. I didn't know what was going to happen. But fortunately, the surgery was successful. Fortunately, the surgeons did not actually see any more cancer. Fortunately, the pathologist, when they took out, I should say, when they studied what the surgeons took out, they didn't see any cancer cells. And so it was really the beginning of my survival. And so I went to bed early, as I normally do, and I woke up in the middle of the night to the news that Chadwick had passed. And at first, I thought it was a nightmare. I mean, you know, like many people, I was shocked. And then, of course, I came to see that it was real. And then I saw that he died of colon cancer. And my first thought was why him? You know, why not me? And it was really, I mean, it was crushing. It was crushing because of how much he had given the world, how much I adored him. It was crushing because I know how beloved he was and still is. And it still is crushing.
Ibram, can you talk about the racial disparities in healthcare, well known by many for so long in this country, but particularly focused on now as a result of the pandemic? The number of African Americans followed by Latinx people, the percentages so disproportionate to population in the United States who die of COVID, not to mention cancer. And you write in How to Be an Anti-Racist, in the United States, African Americans are 25% more likely to die of cancer than whites. My father survived prostate cancer, which kills twice as many black men as it does white men. Breast cancer disproportionately kills black women. If you can talk further about this.
So, yeah, I've had stage four colon cancer. My wife has had breast cancer. My mother has had cancer. My father has had cancer. My grandfather died of cancer. I have an uncle who died of cancer. And cancer, like heart disease, there's all sorts of racial disparities, and just as there are with COVID-19 deaths. And we literally have and have had for quite some time people dying quietly, really an epidemic of death, you know, as a result of racial health disparities. And then we have an epidemic of people blaming those people, blaming those black people, blaming those brown people for dying at higher rates, you know, as opposed to thinking about our system, as opposed to thinking about what policies can we change, as opposed to thinking about why is it that black people, black men in particular, die at higher rates from colon cancer because we're more likely to be diagnosed at a later stage. What is happening in our society that is causing so much black death? Why is black death so normal? How can people allow black people to continue to die of police violence, die of cancer, day in and day out, year in and year out, and not be outraged? And that's why so many people are outraged and demonstrating on the streets and have been demonstrating for months. And they'll be demonstrating for years until this country takes black life seriously.
I want to go, before we talk about what's happening in Kenosha, the police shooting of Jacob Blake, what's happening in Portland, what's happening throughout this country, the issue of white supremacy and President Trump, I want to go to the significance of Chadwick Boseman in Black Panther and what Black Panther meant for so many, not only in this country, but around the world.
I don't even know if I can even, as you know, Amy, I don't even know if it can even be described in words what Black Panther meant, what T'Challa meant, what many of those incredible characters meant, what Wakanda meant, what Wakanda still means to Black people, and particularly those of us who are really striving to be anti-racist, those of us who are knowledgeable about pre-colonial West African empires, those of us who know that the reason why there's so much poverty, for instance, in Africa is not because there's something wrong with African people, that if not for colonialism, if not for the slave trade, there may be a Wakanda. And I think that Black people, I think in the United States and all over the world, for them to see themselves in greatness and in excellence, for them to see themselves affirmed, you know, I think was just incredible. And I remember seeing Black Panther when I was going through chemotherapy. I had been diagnosed weeks before the film came out. And like other Black people who went to see the film, and just as non-Black people, you know, it gave me the ability to really step outside of myself, step outside of my world, and imagine what's possible. And there's nothing more radical and critical to transforming the world than a radical imagination of thinking about what is possible. And I think Black Panther gave that to so many people.
I wanted to go to another clip from Black Panther. Princess Shuri is the little sister of King T'Challa, the king of Wakanda. She's also the chief technology officer, responsible for creating much of Wakanda's tech innovations. In this scene, she's driving a car remotely from Wakanda that the Black Panther is riding in South Korea as he's being chased.
Shuri!
Remote driving system activated.
Wait! Which side of the road is it?
For bus sake, just drive!
Okay, calm down.
That's Princess Shuri. And if you can talk also about the role of women in Black Panther, she's the chief technology officer. And also the idea of not using any resources, natural resources, in of course, the great film director Ryan Coogler's film, for war, like their vibranium. The idea of what a country would look like if they did not pour their money into weapons.
So, yeah, I mean, as a father, as a girl dad, I mean, the portrayal of women in Black Panther is almost certainly what I admire the most, from the chief technology officer to even the baddest person on the film, who to me was the general. And so who was my favorite character and certainly my wife's favorite character. But then also, I just want to, again, emphasize that this is possible. We currently have a tech industry where women, and particularly women of color, are far and away underrepresented, or imagine that it's not their place, or imagine that they don't have the intellectual capacity. And these are all sexist and racist lies. And women, and particularly women of color, you know, can be the chief technology officer of the baddest place, I should say, the most technologically advanced sort of companies or places on earth. That's possible if we can create that type of sort of society.
So it is astounding that Chadwick Boseman did not only Black Panther, and Ryan Coogler wrote about this in his post this weekend, saying he himself, the director of Black Panther, did not know about Chad's personal battle with colon cancer. He wrote a moving tribute to Chadwick Boseman after his passing. In it, he writes, "Chad was an anomaly. He was calm, assured, constantly studying, but also kind, comforting, had the warmest laugh in the world, and eyes that seen much beyond his years, but could still sparkle like a child seeing something for the first time. It's with a heavy heart and a sense of deep gratitude to have ever been in his presence that I have to reckon with the fact that Chad is an ancestor now, and I know that he will watch over us until we meet again." The words of Ryan Coogler. Now, in the film Black Panther, they actually speak Xhosa, the South African language. And your middle name, Professor Ibram X. Kendi, is Xhosa. Is that right?
Yes, Ilani. Yes. And I'm at the same time shocked that Chadwick was able to still continue his craft. Particularly because it's so physically demanding on the body. But at the same time, you know, I'm not shocked. And I know that when I was diagnosed with colon cancer, I was in the middle of writing How to Be an Anti-Racist. And all I can think of was I wanted to do this before I died. I wanted to leave this legacy. I wanted to leave this critically important book for people. And so I was really thinking about ensuring that I finished this before I passed away. And I wonder if that's what he was thinking too, that he wanted to give as much as he could to the world because he knew his time was short. And it did not matter how uncomfortable it was. It didn't matter how hard it was. It didn't matter how painful it was to get out of bed. He was thinking about what he wanted to provide for the world. And it really just shows me his level of courage. It shows me his level of commitment. And it really shows me how much he loved humanity, that he gave so much to us during his last few years.
L.A. Lakers star LeBron James paid tribute to Chadwick Boseman before the Lakers playoff game against the Portland Trail Blazers by taking a knee during the national anthem and crossing his arms across his chest to give the Wakanda Forever salute. This is LeBron James speaking Sunday about Chadwick Boseman.
We're already limited in the sense that, you know, given that type of power, that type of stage that he had, and especially in that industry, you don't see many black male and female actors being able to put on that stage. And for him to be as transcendent as he was, but then you add on the fact that, you know, growing up as a black kid, you had superheroes that you looked up to, but they weren't black. You know, you had Batman, you had Superman, you had Spider-Man, and so on and so on. And for Ryan Coogler and for that cast, for him himself to be able to make Black Panther, that even though we knew it was like a fictional story, it actually felt real. It actually felt like we finally had our Black superhero and nobody can touch us.
So that's LeBron James. I also want to add, of course, if you could talk about Wakanda being a country, what a African country looks like that's not colonized.
And it's fascinating because that is possible. And certainly before colonization, some of the greatest and most powerful and wealthiest and most technologically and intellectually advanced empires in the world were in Africa, you know, from Ghana, Mali, and Songhai. I remember over the weekend when I think it was Forbes magazine stated that Jeff Bezos was the richest man that ever lived. And a lot of people corrected him and said, no, actually, Mansa Musa, who was the king of Mali, was reportedly even wealthier than Jeff Bezos. But indeed, Mansa Musa gave away a lot of his wealth. He actually traveled on this massive pilgrimage to Egypt, and he gave away so much gold in Egypt, he literally destroyed the economy. But people don't know these stories, right? We're not taught about pre-colonial West Africa. We're not even taught about Africa today. You know, I remember going to Africa for the first time and people asking me the weirdest questions, you know, about Africa. And it just goes to show me how little we're taught about Africa and how much we're taught about Europe. And either we're a multicultural nation with people who come from Africa and Latin America and Asia and Europe, and we're going to really teach our children and teach our adults about all these different places, just as we're teaching them about Native American history and culture, or we're gonna focus on Europe. And I don't think we should focus on Europe because that's a demonstration to me of racism.
I wanted to talk about Jackie Robinson in the film 42. Major League Baseball celebrated Jackie Robinson Day Friday, August 28th. It was on that day in 1945, before the March on Washington on August 28th, 1963, before Emmett Till was murdered August 28th, 1955, that the baseball executive, Branch Rickey, met with Jackie Robinson and signed him to a contract with the minor leagues. 2 years later, he would become the first black player in Major League Baseball, where he wore jersey number 42. That's why in the midst of the protests protest this week for Jacob Blake. The New York Mets and Miami Marlins stood for 42 seconds on the field Thursday, then left without playing the game, leaving behind one Black Lives Matter T-shirt on home plate. Well, Chadwick Boseman passed away on August 28th, the day Major League Baseball celebrated Jackie Robinson, the legend that Boseman played in his breakout role in the 2013 film 42. This is a clip.
Give me a uniform. Give me a number on my back. I'll give you the guts.
I father, I Brooklyn Dodger them. I Jack, I Rob, I send. Man, I'm Jackie Robinson, except when I run base, I dodge the pen.
I'm just a ball player. You a hero.
Why don't you look in the mirror? This is a white man's game.
I'm not going anywhere. I'm right here.
I'm a Brooklyn boy. I may take some getting used to.
Maybe tomorrow we'll all wear 42.
And everyone should watch Chadwick Boseman in 42 before we take on James Brown. And then we're going to talk about what's happening in this country. Of course, it's all related. The history is integral to what's happening now. The role of major league athletes from the WNBA, the Women's Basketball League, to the NBA, to football players, to what, the baseball league, MLB, which is now down to 10% African American, still across the board recognizing that they have to speak up, their significance this week and beyond. Professor Kendi.
Well, I mean, to compare this to Chadwick, I mean, and even Jackie Robinson and even T'Challa, for many people, particularly many young people, they see professional athletes, men and women, as superheroes, as heroes, as their heroes. And so to see those heroes, to see those superheroes just demonstrate against racism, speak out against police brutality, decide that, no, we're human too. We're in pain too. We're suffering too. We're outraged too, and we want justice too, so we can't play tonight. We can't play today. I think was just galvanizing for so many people and affirming for so many people.
Now I wanted to go to the 2014 film Get On Up, in which Chadwick Boseman plays James Brown, known as the Godfather of Soul.
I got a year. When I hit that stage, you people better be ready. Especially the white folks.
Every man in this band walk taller because they were James Brown.
Are we done, Mr. Bird?
I'm afraid not, Mr. Brown.
I say, are we done?
I think we got more funk in the trunk. Open up your ears. Man's a genius.
James Brown. James Brown, Ibram Kendi.
Well, I mean, I, of course, came to know Chadwick's work through his portrayal of Jackie Robinson, but I actually really loved his portrayal of James Brown. And I don't know whether it's because I'm a student of the Black Power movement, or I don't know whether it's because James Brown was such a fascinating, complex sort of historical character, or whether that James Brown, and particularly his song, Say It Loud, I'm Black and I'm Proud, was in many ways as galvanizing for Black people and as beloved by Black people who love themselves, you know, as Black Panther. But there was something about that film, and I just think it's critically important for people to not sort of make it seem as if Chadwick only did Black Panther, because he was incredible in several other films. And more importantly, he played these incredible sort of characters and these complex characters and these Black men in particular who triumphed, you know, over so much adversity during extremely difficult times. And so I can then see how he personally could triumph over his cancer, to be able to play those final roles.
We're going to break and then come back to what's happening today. Of course, Chadwick Boseman also played Thurgood Marshall, the first African-American Supreme Court justice. We're speaking with Ibram X. Kendi, the Andrew W. Mellon Professor in the Humanities at Boston University, BU, the founding director of the BU Center for Anti-Racist Research. This is Democracy Now! President Trump promises to go to Kenosha, Wisconsin tomorrow. The governor, the lieutenant governor, are pleading with him not to come. Stay with us.
Say no to the devil. Say no. Say no to the devil. Say no. Well, the devil is a deceiver. He won't treat nobody right. Say no to the devil. Say no. Well, the devil ain't no, say no. Well, the devil ain't no trouble, say no. Well, the devil is a deceiver. He won't treat nobody right. Say no to the devil, say no. Don't you pay no mind to the devil, say no. Don't you pay no mind to the devil, say no. Well, the devil is a deceiver, now he won't treat nobody right. Say no to the devil.
Say no to the devil, no. By Reverend Gary Davis. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman. We're spending the hour with now Boston University professor Ibram X. Kendi, founding director of the BU Center for Anti-Racist Research, contributing writer at The Atlantic, author of many books, including Stamped from the Beginning, The Definitive History of Racist Ideas in America, which won the National Book Award for Nonfiction, and How to Be an Anti-Racist. Well, as we said on Friday, thousands gathered for the 57th March on Washington and the National Mall for an event organized by the National Action Network. Among those who spoke were family members of victims of police violence. This is Jacob Blake Sr., the father of Jacob Blake, followed by George Floyd's brother, Philonis Floyd, and the mother of Breonna Taylor, Tamika Palmer.
We're going to hold court today. We're going to hold court on systematic racism. We're gonna have court right now. Guilty.
Yeah.
Guilty. Guilty.
Guilty.
Racism against all of us. Guilty.
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 Racism against Trayvon Martin. We find them guilty.
Guilty.
Racism against George Floyd. We find them guilty.
Guilty.
Racism against Jacob Blake.
Come on.
Abdul Dawala. If I said the name wrong, Allah forgive me. Guilty.
Guilty.
And we're not taking it anymore.
I wish George were here to see this right now. That's who I'm marching for. I'm marching for George, for Breonna, for Ahmaud.
So there you have the march on August 28th, the anniversary of the March on Washington. We are going to turn right now to Ibram X. Kendi to talk about the significance of what has been taking place and President Trump promising to go to Kenosha, Wisconsin, despite the pleading of the governor of Wisconsin, Evers, the lieutenant governor, the first African-American lieutenant governor, Mandela Barnes. He says he's going to Kenosha, Wisconsin, tomorrow. Can you talk about the latest, Professor Kendi, from Kenosha to Portland to the Republican convention, to the issue of white supremacy in this country? You've used the metaphor of cancer to describe what we are confronting in America today.
Yeah, so, I mean, the United States is facing a form of metastatic cancer, a form of metastatic racism, in which literally racism has spread to every part of the body politic. And how do we know that?
We know that because racial inequities and injustices are all around us. And we see the pain that is stemming from that metastatic racism. We see the people whose lives are being lost. And then we have a president who's claiming that it doesn't exist. You know, just as Jacob Blake Sr. sort of charges America with guilty, America, particularly Americans like Trump, are saying, no, not guilty, not racist. And meanwhile, you know, so many people are, you know, are dying of COVID-19 because of the administration, of course, trying to look the other way, or so many Black and brown and indigenous people are dying at disproportionate rates. All the while, people are saying, not racist. All the while, people are denying the existence of this spread. And what happens when you deny the existence of cancer, of the spread of cancer, of even certainly the spread of racism? It's only going to get worse. And we see what we've been seeing this summer is it's only going to get worse, and it's only going to continue to get worse until we face it, until we admit it, until we acknowledge that indeed we have racism that's spread to every part of the body politic. But then you have people who are aware of it, but then they don't want to get the treatment because the treatment is painful. The treatment is uncomfortable. Yes, the treatment is going to be painful or uncomfortable, but it's the only thing that's going to give us as a nation and as a people the chance to live.
You have the situation in Kenosha where a white police officer at point blank range last Sunday shoots Jacob Blake at least 7 times. Jacob Blake, whose father is also Jacob Blake and whose grandfather is also Jacob Blake. He is the well-known pastor in Chicago who led the housing desegregation movement, and an organization that he co-founded called NOW has a housing complex name for him, the Jacob Blake Manor. The young 29-year-old, now paralyzed Jacob Blake, grew up, went to high school and middle school in Evanston, where his grandfather did his ministry and his civil rights work. And then you have Kyle Rittenhouse, the 17-year-old who turned himself in. I emphasize this because he was on the streets of Kenosha. He allegedly gunned down 2 Black Lives Matter protesters, murdered them on Tuesday night. This is during the Republican convention. The Trump administration, neither Pence nor President Trump mentioned this. He is illegally carrying a long gun, an AR-15, through the streets with his hands up in the air. The police do not stop him, as so many protesters are saying, he just murdered people. Now he's been accused of charged with first-degree intentional homicide. But he drove home to Illinois and turned himself in. That's what it took to get him to stop. Your thoughts? He's a white militia member, 17 years old, wannabe cop.
Well, first, the fact that he's a wannabe cop demonstrates the types of folks, particularly the types of white men who are currently attracted to American policing. And so then the question becomes, why are so many white disaffected, racist young men who want to shoot and kill and get away with it, being attracted to American policing? But I think what's also fascinating is that it is improbable, it is impossible for a Black person to be holding an AR-15 and walking towards the police and walking away from people who are saying they just shot someone, and for the police to let him go on by. I mean, that is impossible. But it's possible when it comes to white people, because even when white people are armed, they seem unarmed, even to police officers. But when Black people are unarmed, they're armed and dangerous. And I think that's fundamentally the sickness of racist ideas, that it allows for so many
people who are unarmed and certainly not dangerous to die, while so many people who are white, who are armed and dangerous and just shot people, to go to their home and sleep in their bed and certainly to not be harassed by the police.
In response to Jacob Kendi being handcuffed to his hospital bed, you tweeted, Professor Kendi, Jacob Blake being handcuffed to his hospital bed. You tweeted, an allegory of what racism has done to black communities, paralyzed economically and politically, fighting hard to recover, but inexplicably still shackled.
Yeah, I mean, like so many people, I mean, I was just, you know, outraged that Jacob had not committed a crime. He was shot 7 times in the back. He was paralyzed. And then on top of that, he is being sort of chained to a bed as if he's the criminal. And again, that's part of the problem is the black victim, the person who was unarmed and shot in the back 7 times, is still being framed by America or by the state or by police officers as the criminal. And because of blackness, it doesn't really matter. And I think that's what people are so outraged by, you know, because his life does not matter, even when he's, you know, the victim of a hail of gunfire and he's paralyzed. He still is viewed as somebody who's dangerous that needs to be shackled.
How has the work of anti-racist protesters over the last decades, over the last centuries, what do you think people should be doing now in this absolutely critical period, what some call the most important moment, especially this election, in U.S. history?
Well, I think first and foremost, no one should be fooled by law and order rhetoric, you know, that's coming from the Trump administration. When they speak of law and order, they're talking about the law and order of racism and black death. That's what they want. And if you support law and order, then you support the order of black death and racism. But I think more importantly, we should be joining organizations and supporting organizations that are challenging racism and racist policy and white supremacy. You know, we should certainly be thinking very seriously about voting for folks who are striving to be anti-racist. But even more than that, we should figure out ways to be civically engaged. Every single one of us has power. We have the power to resist. We have the power to resist policy. We have the power to resist policymakers. And one of the sort of guiding principles that anti-racist activists have sort of lived by for centuries, for decades, for years, for months, is that they have the power, because racist power has been trying to convince us that we don't have power, whether it's enslaved people or even people today who are trying to figure out what can they do in the face of this juggernaut of racism. Don't think ever that you don't have the power. And the way we have power is by coming together, is by organizing together, is by challenging through our organizational strength.
Would you call President Trump a white supremacist?
Oh, without question. And I mean, and anyone who in any way can make a case that he is not a white supremacist based on what he says and based on what he does, and that he's not a racist. And again, I'm only stating this if someone is pushing policies that lead to white supremacy, they're a white supremacist.
Ibram X. Kendi, we thank you so much for spending this hour with us. Andrew W. Mellon, professor in the humanities at Boston University, founding director of the BU Center for Anti-Racist Research. To see all our coverage of Black Panther, Afrofuturism,